It's Thursday, January 9th, and welcome to the New York Amsterdam News Podcast. I'm Cyril Josh Barker, coming to you from the offices of the New York Amsterdam News in Harlem. On this week's podcast, our special guest is newspaper editor and author Wanda Lloyd, who's going to speak with us about her career and her new book. A newspaper editor for more than four decades, Wanda Lloyd is the author of the memoir Coming Full Circle, From Jim Crow to Journalism. During her career, she worked at seven daily newspapers, including the Washington Post, USA Today, the Miami Herald, and others. Wanda retired from daily journalism after serving more than 8 years as executive editor of the Montgomery Advertiser, the daily newspaper in Alabama's capital city. She was recently inducted into the National Association of Black Journalists Hall of Fame, and right now she's with us on the phone from her home in Savannah, Georgia. Wanda, how's it going?
It's going well, Josh. Thank you for having me.
Well, I have to be very frank and honest here. Wanda Lloyd was my very, very first boss when I was out of college. I graduated from Alabama State University, and she gave me my first job, so I have to do full disclosure. We've known each other for a number of years, and I'm so happy to be talking to her about this wonderful, wonderful book. So thank you so much again for coming on.
Thank you.
Well, let's just get started here. So tell us first and foremost about your career. You've had such a story celebrated career for several decades. I'd like you to talk to us about it, because a lot of people might not know that there have been black people working in newspapers and working in media for many, many, many years. So can you tell us a little bit about that?
Sure. Well, you know, when I started in the newspaper business, there weren't many black people working in daily newspaper journalism. That is what we call mainstream journalism. Mm-hmm. You know, the black press has been around for a long time, and you guys do wonderful work. Most black newspapers are weekly papers, and daily papers generally are what we call mainstream. They address all audiences. And so I started in 1970 at the Providence Evening Bulletin in Rhode Island. And my goal was to work in daily newspapers my entire career, and I just did just that, working at seven daily newspapers from Rhode Island to Miami, including the Washington Post and USA Today.
Wonderful. And tell us about some of the adversity you faced, because during that time, there weren't a lot of us in there. If there were, I know in some situations you were the only one. Tell us about some of the adversity that you faced working in those newsrooms back in those days.
Yeah, I'm not sure I would call it adversity in the very beginning, but it was just lonely, I guess is the best way to put it, because I was the only in a lot of situations. I was the only female in some cases in terms of being an editor, and I was obviously the only black person when we first started. You know, when the industry really didn't start counting the number of people of color in newsrooms until 1978. I started in 1970, but in 1978 we were just about 4.5% of the total newsroom population of all daily newspapers.
Wow.
And we have just barely, I haven't looked at the latest numbers, but we're somewhere between 12.5% and 13%.
Oh.
So the numbers have always been very low when you consider that what you really want, the goal should be to what we call reach parity. That is, we should mirror the population. So if we're, you know, 30% people of color in the country, and we're only 12.5% to 13% in newsrooms, that tells you a lot about some of the issues with covering the community.
Absolutely.
In which cases, when I started, you know, the only news in a lot of daily newspapers about people of color, especially black people, was negative.
Mm-hmm.
And that was probably the worst outcome for considering the numbers. When you only see black people, especially young black men, in situations where there are stories about crime.
Right.
When we know good and well that young black men are doing a lot of positive things in the community.
Absolutely.
Going to
college,
you know, having wonderful careers and family people and contributing to their communities. But newspapers just didn't cover that very well for a long time. And in some cases, we're still seeing some of that, I think.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. We have that issue here. A lot of people think it's a Southern thing, but, you know, it's actually a problem up here in the North, too, with New York and New Jersey and the coverage that we have. Yeah.
Yeah, it's not a Southern thing.
Mm-hmm. absolutely. Well, I want to go back a little bit because I remember when I first heard you speak, the very first time I met you, I was in my junior year of college, and you spoke at our school and you talked about how you started writing. And I want you to tell us that story about how you started writing.
College track in classes. I was taking a lot of heavy classes, you know, science classes and language classes and math classes and higher level English classes. And I was thinking that I wanted to take something that looked a little, I guess I would say, easier or something that wasn't as complex. And I found this journalism class in the curriculum in my high school. So I took it in the 11th grade. And at the end of 11th grade, my journalism teacher, Mrs. Law, said, you know, you're a very good writer, and more importantly, I see you as a leader, because a lot of the other students come to you for help with their stories. You have good story ideas. And so she appointed me to be editor-in-chief of the Beach Beacon at my high school, Beach High School in Savannah, Georgia, my senior year. And I decided at the end of 11th grade, you know, this looks like a good career for me. So that was my goal, and I told my family that I was going to pursue journalism. Funny story, and I probably told you this that day at Alabama State. When I announced to my family that I was going to pursue journalism and work at a daily newspaper, my grandmother said something like, well, Wanda, I don't think I know any colored girls who can work in daily newspapers. So I guess I defied the odds in her name.
Okay.
In her eyes. Mm-hmm.
Wonderful, wonderful. In your book, you talk a lot about several things. Well, let me just say this. It's always nice when you're a journalist and you meet other writers and you know colleagues, because they always write books and you've always wanted to know what their life was like. And one of the things that you told me about this book is that it's not a rags-to-riches story. And I say that to say, when we learn about the civil rights movement, what was happening in the 60s and during Jim Crow, the way that it's taught to us, I'm considered a later millennial, is that it was a very depressing time, and that a lot of black people weren't happy, and that we weren't doing things. Tell us about your life living in the South. You come from a very wonderful family, and just tell us about that.
Sure. Well, it's a disclaimer that I make early in the book. It may even be in the introduction, because I don't want people to come to my story thinking that I grew up poor, that I had problems with getting a good education. I grew up in a family that was pretty well educated, including and especially women. I went to Spelman College. I was the third generation in my family to go to Spelman College, which was
amazing.
Very unusual in the 1960s to have three generations of women who were college educated, much less educated at the same school. So my family was educated. We were, it was a family of teachers. It was a family. We had our own business. My dad owned a funeral home in Savannah. So it was a professional family. My mom, my birth mother left me with my aunt and uncle at my request. I wanted to stay in Savannah. She went off to New Jersey and New York City and Dallas and San Francisco and pursued her career with the Army and Air Force Exchange Service as a buyer.
Mm-hmm.
But I had the opportunity to write her letters just about every week, I think. I wrote her a letter, and she took those letters. She recognized some grammar errors. She recognized some spelling errors, and she would mark them up with a red pen and send them back to me, and then have me rewrite the letter with the correct information.
Oh.
So it was a family that really cared about education. My aunt, who raised me, was a teacher with a master's degree in reading, and she set up a library in a closet in our house.
Mm-hmm.
And I considered that library sort of my sanctuary, and I would go up there and pluck a book off the shelf and sit down on the floor and read books. She taught sixth grade for a long time, and
okay.
I guess when I was in like the third or fourth grade, I was reading some of her sixth grade books, and then she bought me a set of encyclopedias, and I was able to just sit there and dream about things that I couldn't see
Wow.
By reading.
It's amazing. I guess I kind of had a similar upbringing. I think I told my father one day I didn't want to read. I didn't like to read. So he bought me all these classics, you know, that were designed to read well for children. And so I totally know what you mean when parents and families want us to be our best. So that's totally amazing. When we're talking about an era like the Civil Rights Movement, when we're talking about being in the American South in the 50s and 60s and prior to that, we hear a lot of stories about things that were happening to our folks, the injustices that happened. What are some things that happened growing up in the segregated South that you can tell us about?
Well, you know, the Jim Crow era was one in which it was legal to discriminate against black people.
Mm-hmm.
It was a period where we were told where we could not live, where we could not go to school. And notice I'm using the word not necessarily could. where we could not eat meals, where we had to shop, what doors we could go through in certain buildings, especially public buildings, of course, what water fountains and what bathrooms we used. So there were a lot of restrictions on what we could and could not do. And but there was also this federal law that said we had to have separate but equal accommodations in some cases, especially in education. And so there was a dual system in the Jim Crow South.
Okay.
Where, you know, we had, for example, in our school every year, we would have the opportunity to go downtown to the city auditorium and listen to the symphony.
Right.
But they would have a day for white students to go, and they would have a day for black students to go.
Mm-hmm.
And so there was no mixing of the races.
Oh.
We heard the symphony, and I assume we heard the same music. I don't know that for a fact. But we could not go together with people who did not look like us. It also affected jobs. There were so many people, especially in Savannah, who were college educated, because we have Savannah State University here and Georgia.
Right,
has
right.
Many HBCU institutions at the time. And so black people were going to college, but once they got out of college, unless they were going into fields like teaching or preaching, or in some cases nursing, it was very difficult for black people to find jobs. And so we had a lot of people who had college educations who were, I would say, I like to say it this way, they were wearing uniforms to work. You know what I mean?
Oh, okay, I get what you mean. Yeah, I get what you mean.
Jobs. They were, in some cases, service jobs. In some cases, they were working for the post office, which was really a good job.
Okay.
For a black man, and they were all men at the time, to be who was college educated to actually be work for the postal service.
Mm-hmm.
So it was that separate but equal system worked to a disadvantage because it sort of held us down. But I have to say, in my experience, we didn't really sit around every day thinking about, oh, poor, you know, woe is me and poor me.
Right, right, right.
In existence. You know, we were living in an all-black neighborhood,
mm-hmm.
and there were, you know, two-parent families where the woman would leave dressed professionally because most of the time she was going to school to teach.
Okay.
And the man would leave with a uniform, but they came together on times when they weren't working. They, you know, everybody looked good, everybody went to church, everybody went shopping on Saturday as a family. You couldn't tell what people were doing when they weren't going to work. And,
okay.
You know, it was a very cohesive kind of existence for us.
Wonderful. So since we're on this topic, you know, we're only about maybe a week or two away from the Martin Luther King Day holiday. And I know that you were there. You saw everything that happened. Can you tell us what you saw? I know it's always nice to hear stories from folks about the movement and the Civil Rights Movement. Were you involved? Did you participate? Did your family members participate? Tell us about that.
I was told that my grandfather was the president or some officer with the Savannah branch of the NAACP. I was too young. He died when I was a year old.
Oh, okay.
I was too
okay.
young to be involved in that. He died in 1950. So I really didn't get to know him, but I remember seeing the loving cups on the mantle in my grandmother's house. Loving
mm-hmm.
cups are these silver cups, look like wine glasses, but they're made
okay.
of metal, and they have an inscription on it, you know, sort of like a trophy.
Yes, yes, yes.
That, you know, has your name and the organization, why you got this little commendation, I guess you would call it. And so I know he was involved with the NAACP. The women who are teachers were not involved with the NAACP because they were threatened that they would lose their jobs if they were.
Oh, wow.
Anyone who worked for the government was told they couldn't work for the NAACP, or with the NAACP, I should say. I was on the young side when the movement came along, but I do remember the boycott that we had in Savannah, where we boycotted all the downtown stores.
Okay.
For a couple of years, we did not shop downtown because we were trying to get the stores to hire black people as professionals. The only jobs that black people could get in those stores on Broughton Street, which is our sort of main street.
Yes.
The only jobs black people could get was sweeping the floor or stocking the shelves.
Oh,
they
could
not sell behind the counters. And a really good job was, you know, elevator operators back in the day when there were manual elevator operators. So the boycott was partly for that reason and partly because we wanted equal accommodations at things like lunch counters, restaurants downtown. There was a department store called Levy's Department Store, and they had a really nice restaurant, a little white tablecloth restaurant inside the department store.
Okay.
And I always asked my grandmother, why can't we go in there and eat? And she would always sort of grab me by the neck or something and say, come on, girl, we're going to go shopping. We can't eat in there. And I always wondered why she fed me before we would go to Levy's, because she didn't want me to be hungry, because you could smell the food as soon as you walked in into the store, because it was just such a nice place. So, but we could not. So we were boycotting to have the ability to be accommodated in all ways at the store. And then the last thing I'll say about the downtown store.
Yes, please.
In some cases, we could not try on clothes.
I've heard that, and I've heard that from a lot of people from that time about trying on clothes. And go ahead and tell us about it.
Well, in some stores, they wouldn't let you try on clothes. They didn't want you to try on hats, shoes. Now, all stores weren't like that, because I do remember trying on some things, but there were situations where we couldn't. So that boycott also, you know, broke down those kinds of barriers. And there were situations where they wouldn't hand you your money. They would put the money on the counter. They didn't want to, I guess, touch black people by handing them their change. So those are the kinds of things that we were battling against. And so we had to find ways to get our clothes in other ways. Fortunately, my grandmother was a seamstress, and so
okay.
She made
all
my clothes. And I had an aunt who lived in, an uncle who lived in New York City, and they would, a couple of times a year, a box would come with shoes in it. Because, you know, my feet were growing, and I had to have new shoes occasionally. And so the shoes would come from other cities. And I assume other families were doing the same thing. They were, you know, getting family members in other places, or buying it in the Sears catalog or something.
Right.
But not going downtown. It really, it was a very successful boycott, and people downtown felt it. Much like, you know, the bus boycott in Montgomery.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah.
You were in Alabama, and you know, it changed things.
It did. Yeah.
And I think those kinds of things happened all over the country.
And it's so interesting that you talk about that, because most, you know, here in New York City, of course, we have a lot of folks who moved from the South and came up here, and they've stayed here for many, 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 many years. And you hear stories about how they would send stuff down to the South, because this is pre-Amazon. We didn't have Amazon like we do now.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. And the aunt and uncle who sent my shoes were from Savannah. They left to go to New York City to be able to be, you know, have a successful
right.
And never came back. They unfortunately passed away in New York City years after.
Oh, okay. Yeah, I myself also, I have family that came up here from South Carolina and some other parts in the South, so I totally get what you say that. One of the things I have to talk about with you is you were on the ground floor of the start of USA Today, and I want you to talk about that time there, what you did there, because that's a major newspaper that's still around. I worked for Gannett. You were there at the start. Tell us about the experience and what it was like getting USA Today off the ground.
Well, USA Today started in, I remember the date, September 15th, 1982. I was not there at the very beginning.
Oh, okay.
I was having a baby, my daughter,
okay.
In 1982. And so when I got a call from a former colleague at another newspaper and asked me to consider coming to work there, I couldn't figure out how to change jobs in the middle of policy in terms of, you know, things like insurance and
right.
time off. The baby was due in August and the newspaper was starting in September, so that wasn't going to give me the opportunity to spend much time. So I didn't go there, but I went when she was 3 years old. I did go to USA Today. And, you know, looking back, I was not what they call a founder of USA Today, but I was really there at the early part.
Okay,
of
okay.
Today. I left the Washington Post to go to USA Today, and I remember when I told my family that I was going to leave the Post. I'd been at the Post for 11 years, and my mother said something like, "Oh, but Wanda, you have a baby and a mortgage. Are you sure this new thing called USA Today is going to make it?" And so I took a chance, and I did go to USA Today for 10 years. It was a very different kind of journalism. You know, there were a lot of naysayers, especially in Washington at the time, about USA Today because they had shorter stories, they had color, colorful pictures, they had graphics. They found news and told stories in different ways than traditional journalism, which at the time was, you know, long, but we call thumb-sucking stories.
Okay,
in the
okay.
Post and the New York Times and even some smaller community newspapers. But USA Today found ways to tell stories in a shorter format using sometimes what we call sidebars, you know, a story to go with a story. They would have graphics that would help tell the story. It was just a very different kind of journalism. And so I did have the opportunity to go as deputy managing editor for enterprise stories. We call them cover stories.
Yes, yes.
And that was a wonderful experience. But I feel like I had to learn a lot because I had to learn how to edit shorter.
Okay.
I had to learn how to not include some of the same information in the graphics and the story, you know, doing what we call breakouts.
Right, right.
But it just gave me a platform to work with a group of people who were younger. I think the average age when I went there was 29.
Oh, wow.
For the whole staff. That included the business staff, everybody, you know, everybody was young because most people were young enough that they could take a chance and do something different. They weren't so, hadn't been in their careers so long that they would be concerned about job security.
Mm-hmm.
It was great being in a place where you could have a crazy idea. Sometimes we would call them crazy ideas. And you could actually, you know, no one would say, well, no, we can't do that because we've always done it another way. And I think that was the best experience for me, not only while I was at USA Today, but even at places I went to, including newspapers I went to after USA Today, because it helped me understand that creativity is a real powerful thing, and we can tell stories in so many different ways. You don't have to tell all the stories in the same way. So USA Today was groundbreaking in many, many ways, and I'm just very proud to have been a part of it for so long. It also gave me a platform for my work in diversity in the newspaper business, because I joined some organizations and became a leader in those organizations and really worked to make sure that we were opening doors for people who were not all white and male.
Wow. And I do want to talk about that, because that's one thing about you that I admire so much, is that I hate to say this, and you and I both know that a lot of times when some of our folks get to certain places, they forget about us. But you are totally different. You have dedicated so much time in your career to making sure that newsrooms are diverse, from your time at the Montgomery Advertiser, from your time at the Greenville News, and other places too. I want you to talk about the Freedoms Forum. A lot of people might not know about it. I know about it, obviously, because I'm in this industry. But tell us about the Freedoms Forum. I know that you were an executive director of it for a number of years.
Yes, well, the Freedom Forum is a nonprofit organization that deals with what I call a lot of news stuff. That is, they spend a lot of time making sure that we understand the five freedoms in the First Amendment. There is a First Amendment Center in Nashville at Vanderbilt University, and just a lot of training to help the public understand the role of the media. And diversity was one of those very important factors that the Freedom Forum spent a lot of energy, a lot of capital, a lot of manpower making sure that newsrooms are diverse. And at some point in about 2000, I think, maybe 1999, they came to me and asked me to consider coming to Nashville and helping to launch a program to teach non-traditional students, all people of color, how to transition their careers. And by non-traditional, these were people who were in other careers. Some of them were in their 20s. All of them, they were past college age. Some of them had graduate degrees. And all the way through age, maybe late 50s or even early 60s, to become daily newspaper journalists.
Okay.
And I, you know, after a lot of conversation over many months, I agreed to leave the Daily Newspaper newsroom and go to Nashville. And we launched the Diversity, the Freedom Forum Diversity Institute at Vanderbilt University. That was the entire name of the program. We built a building on Vanderbilt's campus, and the Freedom Forum paid 100% of the cost of the program
okay.
to bring students from all over the country to. Go through an intensive 12-week program where we work with them sometimes at least six days a week.
Oh, wow.
They were doing something in the program. We were in the classroom 5 days a week, but they were out in the field covering stories on the weekend. We formed a partnership with the Tennessean, which is a daily newspaper Nashville,
mm-hmm.
to have our students write stories and take photographs and create graphics for the Tennessean. And we created internship opportunities at the Tennessean during the program. We paid all the costs for the students to come and live in Nashville, but we also sent for one of the editors in the city and the newspaper where they would go back to come and work with us 1 week during the entire program so that someone in that newsroom would be very familiar with what they were learning and help ease them into the newsroom.
Mm-hmm.
They had a guaranteed job, assuming they finished the program, job to go back to. And as far as I know, at the time I was there about 4 years, we only had one student who did not complete that program. So everybody went back to a job.
Wow, that's amazing. Really amazing.
And many of them are still working in
oh, wow.
Some of them are in the same newsroom from, I guess, they actually launched the program in 2002 when the building was built. Some of them are still working. I'm still friends with them on Facebook. Every
mm-hmm.
now and then I'll get an email from some of them.
Okay. Amazing. One of the things I have to ask you about is, what is your take on the state of media right now? Media is very different, even going back to when I was working with you at the Montgomery Advertiser. And one of the things I remember about you is that ethics were everything. You were always making sure that stories that we covered, things that we did, were always ethically correct and that we're doing things the right way. But with the internet now and all these blogs and everything that's going online with social media, what is your take right now of how media is going? Because now everybody's looking at their phones for the latest news. They're getting news from places that they probably shouldn't be. But what is your take on the state of media right now?
Well, you know, my take on it is mixed. There's still a lot of very good journalism going on. There are a lot of opportunities for very good journalism. There are a lot of schools who are training students who are learning it the right way. They're taking classes in ethics. They're learning the basic skills of journalism. I visited a lot of these schools. I will be visiting on my book tour a lot of the schools that are teaching very good skills. And the opportunities are obviously well beyond newspapers, because newspapers are diminishing in terms of the number of people who read newspapers. But so many people do get their news on the phone. The problem is there's also information coming from places where it's not coming from people who are sort of have the foundation of good journalism that you and I learned in school and practice in our newsrooms.
Mm-hmm.
And it really is up to the user of that information, the consumer, to understand and discern what is real journalism, what is fact, and what's not. This whole term of fake news, I hate fake news.
Right.
It exists.
It does. No, it really does.
And I have to agree with, you know, those who espouse that there is such a thing as fake news. We're not just talking about people who are trying to put out fake news, but people who just don't know how to do it in the right way. And then if you consider all the social media and how people are putting information on social media that they don't verify.
Right, that's the problem. People aren't following up. Yeah,
that's very troubling to me. So, you know, an example, the other day I saw something on social media about a young man, unfortunately, who was found in a gutter or something dead. There were all kinds of rumors about somebody shot him, and, you know, We're afraid to come out of our door. We found out later that, unfortunately, the gentleman had epilepsy.
Mm. Wow.
And probably fell into that, you know, field or wherever he was and died.
Mm. Wow.
As a journalist, you and I know that if we don't cover that, we're going to ask a lot of questions.
Absolutely.
The first question we're going to ask is, was he shot? Well, you know, police officers are going to look at a body in 5 seconds and tell you that it didn't, there was no gunshot, you know, there's no blood. But people aren't asking those questions, and they're not waiting to put that information out. When we were transitioning full force from not just print journalism to digital in Montgomery, when you and I worked in Montgomery, one of the things that I always preach to our staff is we want to be fast, but we want to be correct.
Right, yeah.
And that's really what I regret, that that's not happening all the time.
Yeah. And you're right, because we, you know, you see so many things online from official news sources, and you will see the wrong information or something that you know isn't right, but it's just the fact that everybody wants to get the exclusive, everybody wants to get those hits, everybody wants to get the be the top site or be the top place, and so they put stuff out there. And you know, it's different than it used to be, because you know, nowadays you can, it takes 10 seconds, you can put a story on your phone and put it out there and put it on your news site's website. So yeah, but lastly, I do want to talk to you briefly about the book, Coming Full Circle. And I have to say, this experience talking to you right now is full circle for me. But tell us about the book, Coming Full Circle, From Jim Crow to Journalism.
Mm-hmm. So, you know, when I left the newsroom, I retired from Daily Newspaper. I was executive editor of a Montgomery Advertiser, where you and I worked together for a time, and I left in 2013. I decided that, you know, it was really time to make a change, because newsrooms were changing, the news business was changing.
Right.
And I didn't quite know what I wanted to do, and I was talking to friends and about my career, because people were asking, well, tell us a little bit about your career now that you're retiring. And as I told some of my stories, people started saying, well, when are you going to write this story? One of my best friends is my college roommate, my freshman year roommate at Spelman, Tina McAlonzo, who herself, she herself is an award-winning, best-selling author of 5 novels and publisher, and she's just done so much in the media business. She said, let's talk about a memoir. You know, we talked about how do you write a memoir. I really didn't even know how to start, but she held my hand through that whole process. And when I left Montgomery, and I really thought I was leaving the business and going to retire. And then I got a call to come to Savannah State University, and was hired as the chair of the Department of Journalism and Mass Communications at Savannah State. And a lot of students would ask me over the years that I was working there, well, tell us about your career. How did you get here? Because they knew I hadn't been in the classroom, you know, at a university for very long. And as I told my stories, they encouraged me to write. They would say, when are you going to write this story? When are you going to tell us these stories in writing? So when I left Savannah State, I left after a few years for some family health issues. I decided it was time to really sit down and write this story. So this is a story about a girl who grew up in the segregated South under the restrictive laws of Jim Crow, who dared to become a daily newspaper journalist and ended up working at some of the biggest and best newspapers, and I like to say walked among the giants of journalism. To become an editor and eventually executive editor at the Montgomery Advertiser. And my story tells about some of the experiences I had, some of the experiences that you and I have talked about going through, you know, the period of civil rights, women's rights, what was it like being a woman in a newsroom,
woman
leader in a newsroom, where I'm literally running the daily news meetings 2 or 3 times a day, and how do I do all that? And also, you know, work in some pretty important organizations in the media, like the American Society of Newspaper Editors, where I was on the board for 6 years, and I chaired the diversity committee for a number of years, and I was a Pulitzer juror for 4 years, 4 times. I've done accreditation committee work at universities, and also maintained a family, had a family, and maintained a
absolutely.
Family relationship.
Yeah.
And so young people have asked me over the years, well, how did you do all that? How do you make it all work? And so I hope my story in the book explains a lot about how that all worked and some of the things that I went through. You know, there are some personal stories in there, like, mm-hmm. you know, how I met my husband, and, mm-hmm. you know, there's a personal story about Shelby, the day Shelby was born, because we had some challenges on that day, mm-hmm. worried about her health, but I'm happy to say she's great, she's fine, she's perfect. no, I won't say perfect, she's healthy and she's smart and she's very successful
yes.
in her life. But also, you know, the successes that I've had in newsrooms and helping to cover stories in communities and the contributions that I think we made in communities mm-hmm. as an editor. Okay.
Well, you certainly taught me a lot when I was at the, about to say Amsterdam News, but the Montgomery Advertiser, and even go back to my college years. So you definitely have been doing, you've definitely done some wonderful work, making sure that the next generation of journalists, are doing what we're supposed to do. But the book comes out in February, correct? February 2nd or February?
The book comes out February 4th.
4th, okay.
Launching the book on the 4th in Montgomery at the Rosa Parks Museum on Rosa Parks' birthday.
Oh, okay. Wonderful.
Yeah.
And
we'll
also
be visiting some other cities. Already booked at universities in Nashville, Middle Tennessee State University, Belmont University. I'm going to the Siegenthaler Center on the campus of Vanderbilt, where I used to work. I launched the program there. I'll be at the University of South Carolina on two campuses. I'm working with like a group of people to get back to Spelman College in Atlanta. So there are lots of other places that we're in conversation with, and of course, several places here in the Savannah area. So I'm excited about all of that.
That's wonderful. I have to ask, are you coming to New York anytime soon? Has there been a dead state for New York?
You know, I've had several conversations about New York, and you know, it's very expensive to travel. So
if anybody
out there that wants to invite me to New York and help pay those expenses, we are happy to come. One of the things that I want to do is have a conversation with format in a lot of places, and
okay.
I want to bring my friend and supporter Tina Makawa-Ansa, who also wrote the foreword for my book. I have to say that,
okay.
And we want to have a conversation because she herself is a journalist and has worked as a journalist. But just to talk about writing and talk about our experiences as Black women in newsrooms, that's one of the things we're trying to do. So I would love to come to New York.
Well, we would certainly love to have you. So Well, you know, hopefully we can get you up here and we can talk to some of the folks, young people and folks here in the city who I'm definitely sure would love to hear your story. Well, listen, Wanda, thank you so much for speaking with me today. This was such a treat for me. Again, your book is called Coming Full Circle, and this experience was definitely full circle for me. But thank you so much for being on the podcast today.
And thank you for having me. It's great to be connected with you again, Josh.
All right. Thank you so much. That concludes this week's podcast. You can pick up the latest edition of the New York Amsterdam News on newsstands and get updates online at amsterdamnews.com. You can also keep up with us on Facebook at NY Amsterdam News and follow us on Twitter at NYAmNews. I'm Cyril Josh Barker. Thanks for listening.